Hi everyone and welcome back to the Picture Speak series. I'm Yulia Kasarenko and I use pictures, models and diagrams as communication tools all the time. Today we will create a decision tree, a less frequently used but very effective business analysis technique. What exactly is a decision tree and when to use it? Watch this video to find out. The easiest way to describe a decision tree is a visual representation of a set of business rules that lead you to make a certain decision. Many business decisions involve at least several factors. The more factors, the more variations and decision options. A decision tree can help us show the path to a decision based on a set of factors visually. Often, we start capturing the rules using if-then-else construct. But if you have more than 2-3 factors, they quickly become unmanageable. A decision tree can help us make the conditions more clear. At the same time, it will make it easier to see any gaps or missing conditions. Let's see an example of that. Imagine you are a business analyst and your customer is explaining to you how they calculate the discounts on customer orders. Here is the story. We give discounts to our returning customers. If they always pay on time, we give them 7.5% discount on the next order. For frequent customers, the discount is 10%. The first order can qualify for a 5% discount if the amount is over $1,000. Did the customer give you all the information? Do you have what you need to determine the discounts in different scenarios? Let's work with our example, remembering that it's a fairly simple set of rules. Real business rules can have many more variations and scenarios involved. To figure it out, let's structure the information using the if-then-else construct first. If you have a returning customer, then you also need to know whether they always paid on time. If yes, they will get a 7.5% discount, but only on orders over 25%. So we have here 3 conditions to check before we determine the discount. Returning customer, customer always pays on time, and order amount is greater than $25. If all of these conditions are true, then the discount will be 7.5%. Now what? Suddenly, you discover that you don't know what to do if a returning customer that always paid on time orders something for less than $25. Will they get a smaller discount? Not at all? Flag it as a question. What happens if a customer didn't always pay on time? Another question. As diligent business analysts, we should also clarify the rules and definitions. Using vague words such as always and late may lead to ambiguous requirements. Now, going back to the top if, what if you have a new customer? If they place an order for more than $1,000, they will get 5% off. What we should do otherwise? No discount? That's another question. By now you can see the gaps in the information you received about the existing business rules. Did somebody also mention frequent customers? You may realize that the rules for frequent customers need to be added, if this is not the same as returning customers. Yet another question to clarify. What you may also realize that adding more if-then-else rules and trying to keep track of every condition is becoming tricky. It's especially true if some of the conditions have more than 2 outcomes. In our case, we already have 3 categories of customers: new, returning, and frequent. This makes using if-then-else conditions more convoluted. Which means this is a good time to start creating a decision tree. The simple diagram requires only the most basic shapes. Here are the elements. The nodes capture the conditions that need to be evaluated, or factors. Each condition must have 2 or more mutually exclusive alternatives. Each line or branch will represent one of the alternatives. The tree depths will depend on how many factors you have to evaluate. The final nodes are called leaves and represent each of the possible outcomes. In different literature, you will find examples of decision trees that use circles, ovals, triangles, and other shapes. You can follow various standards. Today, we are learning the concept and will use the simplest shapes. Next, I will demonstrate how to create a decision tree for our customer scenario. All right, so let's start to build our decision tree now. we will only use these following shapes. Empty rectangle will be used for the nodes, and filled rectangle for our leaves or our final outcomes. And I will use lines for branches. So what was our first condition, our first factor? It was a customer type. So let's start with customer type. And as we learned, we have three options here, three customer types that we care about. And that's new. And then we have a returning customer. And I highly recommend that you go back to your client and you make sure that you understand what does it mean, returning customer. For example, you may learn that returning customer is any customer that placed between 1 to 5 orders in the last month. And then the last option is frequent customer. And perhaps you found out that frequent customer is the customer that placed at least 6 orders in the last 6 months. The important condition here is that I have all of the alternative conditions here. And perhaps what I see here is that anyone who hasn't placed any orders in the last 6 months would be considered similar to new. So I will say new or no orders in the last 6 months. So perhaps your discount rules really reward frequent customers. Now we have our three alternatives captured as lines. We need to look at what will be the next conditions we will need to evaluate. Let's look at the new customers. What else do we know? We know from our client that if you are a new customer, whether you get a discount or not depends on order amount. So the order amount will become the next factor here. All right. So what do we know about the order amount? Well, if the order amount is greater than $1,000, that's what you were told, right? During your interview in the story, greater than $1,000, then the discount is going to be 5%. Otherwise, you have asked the question and the client said, otherwise there will be no discount. So what we have now is the leaves, the final decisions for this decision tree. You only need to evaluate two factors, customer type and order amount, for the new customers to determine whether they will get a discount of 5% or no discount. So my other condition will be less than or equal than $1,000, because these need to be mutually exclusive and there should be no other alternative. Now, this is a good time to clarify with your client when you show them this decision tree. What happens if the order amount is exactly $1,000? Is there a discount or not? And perhaps at that point, the client says, well, actually, if it's exactly $1,000, I want to give a discount. So you're going to update this. And now this part is complete. We know what happens for the new customer. Let's now think about the returning customers and frequent customers. What we heard from this story is that whether they'll get a discount in this case depends on whether they are always paying on time. Now, again, we have to clarify, what does it mean always pay on time? Does, if they were customer for 20 years, do we go back 20 years or not? Let's pretend that the customer provided us with a clarification. And what you were told that frequent customers and other returning customers are treated slightly differently. For example, we will be more forgiving for our frequent customers that place a lot of orders. We will give them the best discount if they haven't made any late payments in the last 3 months, where with other customers, we will look at the last 12 months. So we'll have different factors captured here. So what we remember is that if you are a returning customer and if you have never been late for your payments, which means in the last 12 months, the last factor to evaluate is order amount. So let's just look at this and say, okay, if you didn't have any late payments, then we want to evaluate the order amount. Now, if you were late for payments, I don't need to evaluate anything else. You are not getting any discount, right? And then if your order amount is over $25, then you get 74.5%. So if my order amount is greater than $25, I'm getting 7.5% discount. And otherwise, there is no discount. So again, I make sure that all of my conditions add up and I'm mutually exclusive, and I have completed my decision tree for a returning customer. What about my frequent customer? This is information that I was missing from the story. If I'm a frequent customer and I haven't made any late payments, does my discount depend on the order amount or not? Let's just pretend that what you have learned is that no, it doesn't matter that if you're a frequent customer and if you were never late with your payments, then we always give you a discount. So in this case, we don't have any more conditions to evaluate. And we will say, if no late payments, then you get 10% discount. Otherwise, perhaps no discount. Again, I'm assuming that you have clarified every one of these conditions. We forgot to include conditions here. And here, this is where it becomes tricky. If your condition sounds negative, then you may be a little bit confused in terms of what to put here. So instead, what we will do is we will say that we evaluate any late payments in the last 12 months. Were there any late payments in the last 12 months? If yes, then no discount. This is a little bit simpler, and we should aim to have our decision tree as simple as possible. And then if no, if there were no late payments, then we will grant the discount based on the order amount. And then we will do the same here. We will evaluate whether there were any late payments in the last 3 months. And then depending on no or yes, we either get 10% discount or no discount. Here it is, our very simple decision tree. We can always try to make it look a little prettier. Maybe group our leaves a little bit closer together so that it's much more easy to see what's happening. And now we see the path to determine the discount, depending on the type of the customer. And we see when the discount depends on order amount or not, and whether it depends on late payments or not. Of course, for new customer, there were no payments. That's it. And this diagram here contains much more information that was in the original story that your customer told you. It contains much more complete information than the if-then-else statements that we were trying to put together, because we've discovered some gaps. And if you were to try and depict this information as if-then-else, you would probably get lost. So decision trees as well as decision tables are a much better way to capture the sets of business rules, especially if you have, as in this case, at least three different factors, and when some of our conditions have more than two potential alternatives. This is it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you will be using decision trees from now on. It's a very useful, very easy technique, and it really helps you to detect gaps in your business rule sets and capture them accurately. Good luck!